He said a fella needed to be rooted to the land, with a wife to stand beside him, why a man could take a stand. Then he wove together threads of life into a loving plan, while he wandered across the country far and near. Again and then again, with his paper and his pen, his letters fell like whispers in her ear, soft as April. His letters fell like whispers in her ear. He wrote to her of dreams and the ambitions that inspired him. Their letters murmured fantasies, the two of them conspired in. Then he settled in Milwaukee, had a dry goods store that hired him, and he gave the salaried workers life a whirl. So from party organizing, he went to writing advertising. But the best he ever wrote was to his girl.
Special reductions, great sample sale, by God. Low prices, terrific selling. Jesus wept. Quality, God damn it, and prices. Oh hell, sacrifice sale, sacrifice, great offerings. Holy mother of God. Buy from us. Purchase here, for Christ's sake.
Oh, I had a girl and her name was Daisy. When she sang, the cat went crazy with St. Vitus's and deliriums and all kinds of cataleptics. One day she sang a song about a man who turned himself inside out,
and he jumped in the river 'cause he was so very sleepy. Lillian, yes. The permanent job is mine. They'll fire the other man in the morning, begin taking their chances with me. God love Kroger's department store. Yes, it's a long, long way from the Social Democrat Party, but it means we'll get married that much sooner, my love. I'll be getting 20 a week for now, as I understand it. I edit the store news for a bargain circular and make copy for 3 daily papers. Oh, also write the window show cards. Generally, whatever advertising goes into the paper, that will be my responsibility. I'm quite a cog in this machine, if I make good. Old man Kroger says when I've demonstrated that fact, there'll be from 1,000 to 2,000 a year at it. I think that means they'll either raise my pay or fire me within a couple weeks. I can't see how I can fail to make good. No part of this store publicity machinery puzzles me. Beats newspaper work of most kinds. I want you to come on. Come on here, Milwaukee, my darling. If you don't hear from me Thursday night in the mail, then come on. I'll talk to you then. And Lillian, hurry.
Eyes like a morning star, cheeks like a rose. Laura was a pretty girl, God Almighty knows. Weep all ye little rains, wail winds, wail. All along, along, along the Colorado Trail.
It was a beautiful visit, Lillian. But now about the essentials. I like your idea of the wedding doings at the farm. They will look at you so when we go to Galesburg one day. Downtown and at the college, they will look and they will find you baffling and only sense something of the power and beauty and wisdom and love. Something as far off and cross-textured as my poetry and warm and open as myself. They won't understand you any more than me, but they will love you. Yes, you will be good for them. I shall save Sturgeon Bay for the honeymoon. Inasmuch as we recognize some spectral validity in a wedding, we must also concede a period of time immediately following a wedding known as a honeymoon. Yes, we will call it a honeymoon. And then we will have done with concessions to society. We'll do our own christening and baptizing, and if it ever comes to funerals, we'll just read a few lines of Whitman ourselves. Let it go at that. Such an adventure it will be, dear love pal, mate, woman, sweetheart, proud, beautiful Lillian. P.S. I'm sending a 5 with this. It leaves me broke. But I can't raise money when I have money. I'm going to try and have $50 or more for our starting. We'll make a compact that all money from literature sales will go into the baby fund. Should range around $15 or $20 a month and increase at that. And I'll turn over to you every once in a while, if not twice, all there is to spare over our material needs. The baby fund. It will grow, and such a baby it will be, such a reckless cub, never to hear a don't, learning fire by getting burnt, getting religion and ethics and love powers from our kiss in, never knowing that he or she is being educated, just living and unfolding, such a cub.
Went to see my gal on Sunday, holy-um dum diddle-um day. Didn't get back till a week from Monday, holy-um dum diddle-um day. I got a nickel, she's got a dime, holy-um dum diddle-um day. Went to Lynchburg, had a time, holy-um dum diddle-um day.
Reuben, old chum. Well, I wanted you to be the first to know. Lillian and I expect to have a little red babbling heir apparent arrive this summer, June. He or she will probably constitute our vacation, so it'll be up to you and Laura to come up and visit us. Oh, Rubai.
I got a gal on Sourwood Mountain, holy-um dum diddle-um day. So many pretty girls, I can't count them, holy-um dum diddle-um day. Ducks in the pond, geese in the ocean, holy-um dum diddle-um day. Devils and the women, if they get the notion, holy-um dum diddle-um day. Holy-um dum diddle-um day, holy-um dum diddle-um day. Devils and the women, if they get the notion, holy-um dum diddle-um day.
Another baby! Well, we're going to call this one Janet. No, she's fine. She's another lusty howler, like Margaret was. I love it, Reuben. Fatherhood is my natural calling. I think it suits me. My work is mostly with the children now.
In Frisco Bay, there lives a whale. She eats pork chops by the bale, by the hogshead, by the schooner, sometimes by the pillbox. Her name is Luna, she's a peach, but don't leave food within her reach.
Or babies, or nursemaids, or chocolate ice cream sodas. Finally gotten the publishers to take my work seriously. Seriously enough to send me financial advances. I'm working on a collection of short stories for children I'm calling Rutabaga Tales. Really just a series of pieces I've written for little Margaret. Poker Face the Baboon and Hot Dog the Tiger.
When the moon has a green rim, the red meat inside with the black seeds on the red meat.
Then in Rutabaga country, they call it a watermelon moon and look for anything to happen.
It was a night when a watermelon moon was shining.
Lizzie Lazarus went to the upstairs room of the potato-faced blind man.
Poker Face the Baboon and Hot Dog the Tiger were with her.
She was leading them on a pink string.
And on, Reuben. I love to read to these two little wide-eyed girls who giggle. Yes, they giggle, Rube. It's a joy to gather the girls together and tell them stories. Or read from something that I'm writing just for them. The 5 Marvelous Pretzels. 5 nights before Christmas, Five pretzels sat looking out of a grocery window lighted by five candles. Outside?
Snow falling.
Big white snowflakes, soft and quiet.
And they see a man outside the window. He looks in while they look out.
And they see him brushing snow off his left shoulder with his right hand, and brushing snow off his right shoulder with his left hand.
Shaking snow off his hat and putting his hat back on his head.
But they don't hear the man say, "Well, well, well, five pretzels. And how many children is it I have at home running upstairs and downstairs in and out of the corners?
One,
two,
three,
four,
five.
One for each pretzel."
Now, early that afternoon, the five pretzels decide that they will go with a circus and be trapeze actors on billboards everywhere.
The five marvelous pretzels in big letters.
And they run out of their dressing rooms in pink tights, bow to the audience, and throw kisses. One kiss with the right hand, the other kiss with the left hand.
And the man with the big musical megaphone calls,
"The five marvelous pretzels."
Up in the air they go. Two of them hang by their knees and throw the other three pretzels back and forth in the air, in the empty and circumambient air. So far,
so good.
Then they argue.
Fuss.
Dispute.
Wrangle.
Which two will hang by their knees?
And which three will be thrown back and forth in the empty and circumambient air?
All five want to be the two that hang by their knees. None of them want to be thrown back and forth. So they say,
Let's forget it.
Now, they decide instead
that they will ride on the heads of the elephants.
In the vast,
mammoth,
stupendous
parade of the elephants.
On billboards everywhere, people will see on each elephant
one dazzling, glittering little pretzel in pink tights,
bowing and throwing kisses.
One kiss with the right hand, the other kiss with the left hand. Yes,
so they decide.
And just before the first elephant comes out leading the parade,
the man with the big musical megaphone calls,
"The five marvelous pretzels."
So far,
so good.
Then comes the argument.
Who should ride on the head of the first elephant?
And who should come out first, bowing and throwing kisses to the audience?
They argue.
Fuss.
Dispute.
Wrangle.
Then at last, decide.
Whoever rides the first elephant today
rides the last elephant tomorrow.
Then they see the man outside the window.
And they see him brushing snow off his left shoulder with his right hand, brushing snow off his right shoulder with his left hand,
shaking snow off his hat and putting it back on his head.
And the man walks into the store and comes out
with the five pretzels in a paper sack.
And he walks along the street
in the falling snow, big white snowflakes on his shoulders
and on his hat.
And does he know, as he walks along in the falling snow, what happened that afternoon and evening among the pretzels?
No.
Does he know that he has in his sack
the five marvelous pretzels?
No.
Does he know that afternoon they decided to join the circus and be trapeze actors and then change their mind?
No.
Does he know they decided instead that they will ride on the heads of elephants, bow and throw kisses while thousands of people laugh, cheer, and cry,
Look, the five marvelous pretzels.
No.
Then what does the man know about what the pretzels want to be?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Which shows how ignorant some people are.
He's gone away for to stay a little while. And he's coming back if he goes 10,000 miles. Look away over yonder. Look away.
Lillian, dearest, just given another reading, the third reading, the first real quiet reading to the letter you tucked into my pocket as a goodbye note. There were tears in it, and a big gladness, and a strong-hearted woman, my pal, in it. I would not choose to report this war, but I am glad I've been called to cover it. Whenever I see the young men in their coarse wool uniforms going off to France to do battle, I know that ours is not a real separation, only a space between heartbeats. What we are having is only a breath of the world's storm. We will hope that resolves and consecrations enough have been born out of the millions of separations, enough for the remaking of the world. What with your line about Janet waving and Margaret's dear note, It all tugs at me tonight. I got the warm kiss of your calling me buddy at the finish. What we know is that all the chances are in favor of our sitting under our own cherry tree someday and talking about the year that Carl went away. And when I say God keep you, I mean it in its oldest and deepest way. It is a while again until we maintain our establishment, our really truly home. And unless some over-particular people rake up the leaves, it will be a fine yard for a homecoming celebration. It's been mystically wonderful lately, that backyard, with a half moon through the poplars to the south and a haze and rustlings, always high or low rustlings on the ground in the trees, a sort of grand hush, hush, child. And as the moon slanted in last night and the incessant rustlings went on softly, I thought that if we are restless, fail to love life big enough, it's because we've been away too much from the moon and the elemental rustlings. I like Walt Whitman, musing among the ashes of dead soldiers, talking as though he knows there is a thing he calls love, which is a reality finer than death. I haven't got room here to work it out. Soon we should go hand in hand again.
There's a man going round, taking names. There's a man going round, taking names.
With sweet little Janet and Margaret, I'm ready for anything all the time. Every day I come home and I find them alive, I take as a day snatched from death. I think, too, about how they die every week. The Margaret that was learning to talk 3 years ago is dead and replaced with an endless chatterer. The little fluff of a Janet we had a year ago is gone. Every beautiful thing I know is ephemeral, a thing of the moment. Life is a series of things that vanish.
There's a man going round, taking names. There's a man going round, taking names. And he took my brother's name, and he left my heart in pain. There's a man going round, taking names.
I had two brothers go with diphtheria when I was a boy. We had a double funeral on a bitter winter day. My family buried two children that had barely lived long enough to be named, and whenever I think of those two, who emerged into so little of living and then faded off, my head gets into all the big overtones of life, that hazy illusion of time and clocks. We are all such little things. A day of life is a day snatched from death, and the only fool is the one who can prove that death is a blank nothing or something less than life.
Let a joy keep you. Reach out your hands and take it when it runs by, as the Apache dancer clutches his woman. I've seen him live long and laugh aloud, sent on singing, singing, smashed to the heart under the ribs with a terrible love. Joy always. Joy everywhere. Let joy kill you. Keep away from the little deaths.
Lillian and Janet and Margaret, call me back to the white blossoms that were singing all by themselves a wonderful soft peace this morning. This was their first real day for greetings of the season, a quiet summer opening without advertising. All heavy with raindrops, sheer, white, and wild, the sun gleaming rainbows and prisms from them, a pathos of eager living in them. Pathos of eager living in them.
My dearest dear, the time draws near
when you and I must part. But little you know of the grief and woe in my poor aching heart. In my poor aching heart. Oh, hushabye, don't break my heart. Don't let me hear you cry. The best of friends must part sometime, so why not you and I? So why not you and I? Her lips were like the roses fair that bloom in the month of June. Her voice was like a sweet instrument that sang a mournful tune, that sang a mournful tune.
No, there's not much question about it, Rube. She's very sick. Margaret's a very sick little girl. We've seen several doctors about it. It's not exactly fatal. Rube, she's got nocturnal epilepsy. It could if she had a seizure in the middle of the night and she were unattended and alone. It's not fatal in itself, but it's a life sentence for such a little girl. She doesn't understand. She's so confused. She doesn't know what she's done that this should happen to her. She tries very hard. She's very brave. She's a good soldier, Rube. Lillian and I are learning to love her all the more because she is so brave. We just go on a day at a time. That's what we do. We just go on. Sometimes there's nothing left but the work. When the world is falling apart, and the sadness presses on your chest with a terrible weight, and there is no sense to be made out of all the things that seemed in perfect order a little while ago, a man must turn to his work, throw himself at it with a fever, abandon all thought and feeling, and go to work. I am bereft of answers, plans, dreams. I do not know today what I knew yesterday. But there must be a tomorrow. So I shall work.
Ladies and gentlemen, the poet of the prairie, Mr. Carl Sandburg.
I was born on the prairie, and the milk of its wheat, the red of its clover, the eyes of its women gave me a song and a slogan. You came in wagons, making streets and schools, singing Yankee Doodle, old Dan Tucker, Turkey in the Straw. You in the coonskin cap at a log house door, hearing a lone wolf howl. You at a sod house door, reading the blizzards and the chinooks. I am dust of your dust, as I am brother and mother to the copper faces, the worker in flint and clay. I am here when the cities are gone. I am here before the cities come. I last while old wars are fought, while peace broods motherlike, while new wars arise and the fresh killings of young men. I take peace or war. I say nothing and wait. Have you seen a red sunset drip over one of my cornfields? The wave lines of dawn up a wheat valley, out of the prairie? Brown grass crossed with a streamer of wigwam smoke. Here I saw a city rise and say to the peoples round the world, listen, I am strong. I know what I want. I am the prairie mother of men waiting. They are mine, the threshing crews eating beefsteak, the farm boys driving steers to the railroad cattle pens. They are mine. The crowds of people at a 4th of July basket picnic listening to a lawyer read the Declaration of Independence, watching the pinwheels and Roman candles at night, the young men and women two by two hunting the bypaths and kissing bridges. They are mine. The horses looking over a fence in the frost of a late October saying, good morning. to the horses hauling wagons of rutabaga to market. The corn huskers wear leather on their hands. There is no let-up to the wind. Look at six eggs in a mockingbird's nest. Listen to six mockingbirds flinging follies of "Oh, be joyful" over the marshes and uplands. Look at songs hidden in eggs. Oh, prairie mother, I am one of your boys. I have loved the prairie as a man with a heart shot full of pain over love. Here I know I will hanker after nothing so much as one more sunrise or a sky moon of fire doubled to a river moon of water. I speak of new cities and new people. I tell you the past is a bucket of ashes. I tell you yesterday is a wind gone down, a sun dropped in the west. I tell you there is nothing in the world, only an ocean of tomorrows, a sky of tomorrows. I am a brother of the corn huskers who say at sundown, tomorrow is a day.
So we leave our hero with his children and his wife. You can read his poetry to know more of his life.
We leave him with his daughters and his love mate Lillian.
They just go on, they just go on. With faces toward tomorrow they go on.
Dear Margaret, this is only a little letter from your daddy to say that he thinks about you hours and hours, and he knows that there never was a princess nor a fairy worth so much love. We are starting on a long journey and a hard fight, you and mother and daddy and Janet and Helga, all of us. And we are going to go on, slowly, quietly, hand in hand, all of us, never giving up. And so, we are going to win. Slowly, quietly, never giving up. We are going to win. Daddy.
Down in the valley, the valley so low, hang your head over, hear the wind blow, hear the wind blow. Hear the wind blow. Hang your head over. Hear the wind blow.
Writing this letter containing three lines, answer my question, will you be mine?
Will you be mine, dear? Will you be mine? Answer my question, will you be mine? Roses love sunshine, violets love dew, angels in heaven, no, I love you, dear.
know I love you, dear. Know I love you. Angels in heaven, know I love you.
Whether it's your child or friend or very special lover, if you find you're full of love and feelings for another, don't try to hide the light of love or keep it undercover. Don't wait for fate to pull you both apart. I'll tell you what you ought to do. Just tell them what they mean to you. Tell them all the love that's in your heart. Do it now. Tell them all the love that's in your heart.